Nudged Audiobooks presents Villains in Venice by Katherine Woodfine, narrated by Jessica Preddy. Part 1. And so we are back in London again. After all our adventures, I must confess the city seems drab and dull. Nothing is the same as it was before, and I find myself eager to resume our travels once more. Once Papa's business here is complete, and before we return to Cairo, he has promised me a trip to one of the places I most long to see, Italy. So for the present, I shall tolerate grey London while dreaming of blue Italian skies. From the Diary of Alice Grayson. A Norton newspaper, 3rd February 1912. The Daily Picture. Great Britain in peril. Prime Minister responds to German spy threat. The Prime Minister has responded to growing concerns about German espionage taking place in Britain. It is believed that there may be more than 100 German spies at work in our naval ports and London, with the result that considerable information about the British military is now in German hands. Our sources report that details of naval artillery, plans of campaign, code books and wireless telegraphy keys are amongst the material that has already been gathered by these operatives. There is certainly no doubt that there are German spies in Britain attempting to gather military intelligence, stated Prime Minister Arthur Lockwood. But the public should be reassured that this is an issue the government takes very seriously. Measures are being taken by the War Office to ensure that enemy agents will be swiftly identified and arrested. Meanwhile, in Germany, much has been made of the belief that Great Britain was ready to attack and destroy the German naval fleet on several occasions last year. Continued, page 4. Have you encountered a spy? If you have observed something suspicious, let us know. The Daily Picture is offering a £10 reward for letters with information about suspected German spies, sent to Mr. W. James, Spy Editor, The Daily Picture, Norton Newspapers, Fleet Street, London, EC4. Carnival spectacular to take place in Venice. A revival of the 18th century carnival is to take place in Venice, Italy, later this month, with many celebrated personages expected to attend. New York socialite Mrs. V. Davenport will be the hostess of a spectacular gathering at an 15th century palazzo on the Grand Canal, with invited guests including Paris fashion designer César Chevalier, daredevil pilot Antonio Rossi, West End star Mrs. Kitty Whitman, artist Max Kamensky, and newspaper magnate Sir Chester Norton. Entertainment will include a specially devised performance from the Ballet Russe, with refreshments to include traditional Italian delicacies. Continued, page 27. Chapter 1. Charing Cross Road, London. It was sleeting in London as the young man slipped out of the office marked Clark and Sons Shipping Agents, closing the door softly behind him. There was no one to see him, and yet there was something furtive about the way he hurried down the stairs, tucking an envelope into his pocket as he did so. Out in the street, he looked swiftly around him, before unfurling a black umbrella and walking purposefully in the direction of Charing Cross. It was a dingy February morning. Motor taxis and omnibuses swished through the grey slush on the road, and a chilly, miserable-looking newsboy was selling copies of the Daily Picture from outside the brightly lit window of a hat shop, while people well wrapped up in winter coats hurried past him towards the underground railway station. The young man went by with the rest. He didn't glance at the newsboy, nor at any of the bright shop windows he passed, but instead kept on walking, his head down, his face concealed by the black umbrella. He did not slow his pace until he reached the Charing Cross Road, where he turned to duck inside the door of a bookshop, pausing first to shake the sleet off his umbrella. The bell jingled as he stepped through the door. Inside, the shop was warm and snug, the light from the gas lamps fuzzy, the windows fogged, the air rich with the smell of leather bindings and beeswax. He glanced around rapidly, taking in half a dozen people browsing the shelves that stretched from floor to ceiling. A lady in a fur-trimmed hat was flicking through the pages of a book by E.M. Forster, and an old man with a monocle was browsing the shelves of the poetry section. A cluster of schoolchildren was gathered around a stack of detective novels, while behind the counter, the bookseller was patiently listening to a gentleman explaining that he was looking for a book that he'd seen in the shop last year, although he couldn't remember either the title or the name of the author. The young man went past them all, towards the back of the shop. In the dark corner marked foreign languages, he frowned at the shelves before locating a Russian phrasebook and flipping it open. Across the shop, the gentleman at the counter was saying,
"I believe it had a green cover, although now I think about it, it may possibly have been blue,"
while the bookseller listened wearily. Nearby, one of the schoolboys was brandishing a copy of a newly published Montgomery Baxter detective story.
"You've simply got to read this," he was exclaiming to one of his companions. "The ending is awfully thrilling. I can't wait for the next book to find out what happens." "I bet I can guess," said another of the boys with an air of great authority. Then, in a very different voice, "Oh, Jane, you can't buy it. Papa wouldn't like it." "I don't see why I shouldn't," argued the girl beside him, tossing back her plaits. "I've got half a crown of my birthday money to spend." "But look, why don't you get a school story instead, or one of those books of fairy tales?" suggested the boy. He reached towards her and tried to take the copy of Montgomery Baxter and the Lost Treasure out of her hands, but she had no intention of handing it over, and there was a scuffle. The Montgomery Baxter book fell to the floor with a thump, making the other customers look around disapprovingly, and the bookseller frown over the top of his spectacles. In that moment, unnoticed by anyone, the young man swiftly slid the envelope out of his pocket and inside the Russian phrasebook. A minute later, the book was back in its place on the shelf, and the young man had left the shop, pacing back along the street under his umbrella, the bell above the door dinging quietly behind him. At the counter, the bookseller was trying to explain that they had rather a lot of books with green and blue covers, and could Sir possibly remember anything else about the book, otherwise he was afraid he couldn't do much to help. Meanwhile, the girl with plaits had picked up the Montgomery Baxter book. "Murders and crimes and spies and all that sort of thing, they aren't suitable for girls," her brother was blustering as the door opened again and another young man came in. Properly speaking, he wasn't really a young man at all. He was probably only about 16, not much older than the schoolboys clustered around the display of detective stories. He wore a dark blue coat and cap and had a striped woolen scarf around his neck. He might have been an office boy, or perhaps a junior clerk. As he came into the shop, he caught sight of the book in the girl's hand and gave a little grin as he heard what her brother was saying, but then straightened his face almost as once, as if he was remembering he was here on serious business. He went past the detective stories, past the fiction and poetry books, heading for the foreign languages section. Once there, he ran a finger quickly along the spines until it settled on the Russian phrasebook. At the counter, the gentleman looking for the green, or possibly blue, book was tutting to himself and muttering that it was all very unsatisfactory, while the long-suffering bookseller wrapped Montgomery Baxter and the lost treasure for the girl with plaits. The young man fidgeted while he waited to be served, then handed over his money before tucking the Russian phrasebook into his pocket, now neatly wrapped in brown paper. A minute or two later, he was following in the wake of the group of schoolchildren, out of the shop door and into the street, pulling his striped scarf more closely around him. The sleet was falling faster and thicker now. A moment later, he had vanished into its blurry whiteness and disappeared. Chapter 2. Lion's Corner House, London. Not very far away from the Charing Cross Road, Sophie Taylor was sitting by herself at a table in the window of Lion's Corner House. She did not notice the sleet outside the window. Neither was she paying any attention to the cup of tea that was rapidly cooling at her elbow, nor the bun waiting uneaten on a plate. Instead, she leaned her forehead in her hands as she bent over the newspapers spread out on the table in front of her. She was frowning as she scrutinized the pages of the morning edition of the Daily Picture. It did not make very reassuring reading. Threaded between the reports of an expedition to the South Pole and a review of a new play at the Fortune Theatre were several stories about conflict in Europe and beyond. There was unrest in the Balkans, trouble in Morocco, rumours of a rebellion in Albania. To someone else, they might not have meant very much, but for Sophie, they joined together to form a jagged pattern. She felt certain that they were all the doing of the Fraternitas Draconum, the sinister secret society who were working to try and start a terrible war. Most people had never even heard of the Fraternitas. The other customers sitting in Lion's Corner House probably wouldn't have believed that such a group existed. Sophie glanced around, taking in the shoppers with parcels, talking and laughing and drinking tea. They all looked so contented and peaceful. They were not aware of the danger that she could see everywhere, hovering over them like a dark cloud. For Sophie, the Fraternitas and their schemes were all too real. For a while now, she'd been battling against their devious plots to spark off a horrifying war in Europe from which they intended to profit. She'd grappled with everything from shocking murders to royal assassination attempts, and following in the footsteps of her parents, who had given their lives to the fight against the Fraternitas, she had formed a group here in London called the Loyal Order of Lions, who had vowed to work against them. And yet, in spite of all of her efforts, here the Fraternitas were, reaching right across Europe, seemingly stronger and more powerful than ever before. Sophie sighed as she flicked back to the front page. As if that wasn't bad enough, there were the tensions growing between Britain and Germany. It was not news to her that there were German spies in Britain. After all, she'd encountered them herself more than once. But 100 of them? That was just nonsense. She knew the Prime Minister was trying to reassure people, but the front page headline would only fuel everyone's fears and make things worse. It had been 3 years since Sophie had found the missing clockwork sparrow and solved her first mystery. She'd been only 14 then, a more or less ordinary girl with a more or less ordinary job selling hats at Sinclair's department store. Now, she was going on for 18, and she didn't think that anyone could describe her as ordinary any longer. Nor was she a shop girl. Instead, she was one of the proprietors of Taylor & Rose, London's first young ladies' detective agency. What was more, she was also an agent of the government's Secret Service Bureau. 4 years ago, Sophie had been alone with no friends, family, or money. She knew she had been lucky to get a job in any shop, never mind an elegant department store like Sinclair's. Now, she lived a life that most girls of her age couldn't even dream of, running her own business, travelling across Europe by boat, train, and even aeroplane, carrying out secret missions for her country in Paris, and most recently, St. Petersburg. She'd taken on the infamous crime lord known as the Baron and won. And yet, as she sat in the window, flicking through the newspaper, she felt smaller and more powerless than ever before. Under the table, Daisy whined and laid her head in Sophie's lap. Dogs weren't allowed in Lion's Corner House, but the kind-hearted waitress always looked the other way as long as Daisy stayed out of sight. The big Alsatian kept close to them all these days, sleeping curled up under Sophie's desk in the office, pattering after Billy every time he went over to the filing cabinet, and, most heartbreaking of all, jumping up hopefully every time someone came to the door, wagging her tail as though this time it was certain to be Joe, coming back to them at last. Sometimes Sophie let herself imagine it too. The soft sound of feet outside the door. Daisy bounding up and barking joyfully. The door swinging open and Joe strolling in, wearing his old jacket that smelled of the stables. He'd say, "Hello, Soph," just as though he'd seen her only yesterday. No one else ever called her Soph. The thought gave her a sharp pain, jagged, like broken glass. It had been 3 months since Sophie and Lil had returned from St. Petersburg. 3 months since they'd come back to London, excited to tell Billy and Joe about their adventures, but they'd found only Billy waiting for them, anxious and alone. Ever since they'd solved the mystery of the clockwork sparrow, the four of them had been a team. There were others who worked with them, first and foremost May Lim, who was their receptionist and handled much of the important office work, from booking appointments to arranging payments. Then there was Tilly Black, who was Taylor and Rose's technical expert. But at the centre of it all were Lil and Sophie, Billy and Joe. Even when she and Lil had begun travelling abroad on missions for the Bureau, they'd always known that Joe and Billy were in London, keeping things going. Keeping the home fires burning, she thought. After all, Taylor and Rose was a kind of home for all of them, and for her most especially. Because while Billy had his mum and Uncle Sid, and Lil had her older brother Jack, Sophie was all alone in the world. Taylor and Rose was her family. And she knew without them ever having discussed it that Joe had felt exactly the same. Now, Joe was gone. In St. Petersburg, Sophie and Lil had learned there was a double agent at the Bureau, someone passing top-secret inside information to the Fraternitas Drachnum. While they had been away, Joe had discovered the same thing. He'd seen documents being smuggled out of the Bureau and passed to a woman whom he'd followed to the offices of the Daily Picture. He'd gone out in search of the mysterious woman to try and find out more, but he had never come back. They'd set out to look for him straight away, of course. Sophie and Lil were no strangers to finding missing persons, and they'd put their detective skills to work, recruiting all the other members of the Loyal Order of Lions to help them, and consulting their friends at Scotland Yard. They'd gone up and down Fleet Street, talking to everyone from street cleaners to shopkeepers. They'd spent days freezing themselves in the embankment gardens, watching the statue where Joe had seen the handover of the confidential information take place. They'd quizzed the staff of Sinclair's in case any of them might know something, and they'd talked to the people in the East End who knew Joe, not only May's family, but Mr. and Mrs. Perks from the Seven Stars Inn, and old Samuel in Limehouse, who'd once taught Sophie to crack a safe. But as day after day went by without a single clue, Sophie had begun to feel a rising sense of dread. The fraternitas were utterly ruthless, and if Joe had crossed their path, she knew he would have found himself in the very gravest danger. Billy had been beside himself.
"He told me he saw the double agent come out of the bureau. He followed them, but he didn't know for sure who they were,"
he'd fretted.
"I ought to have asked him more questions. I ought to have gone with him to the offices. If only I'd been there, then maybe..."
His voice had trailed miserably away.
"You couldn't have known what was going to happen," Lil had said, refusing to think the worst.
"Cheer up. I bet he'll turn up at any moment. You know Joe, he's so thorough. He's probably off following a lead."
But all the time, Sophie's feeling of dread had been growing worse and worse. In the end, it had been their old friend, Detective Sergeant Thomas of Scotland Yard, who had brought the news she feared. He'd arrived at the Taylor and Rose offices carrying a navy blue Sinclair's cap stained with something dark. Sophie had recognized it at once, even before Billy's horrified exclamation,
"That's Joe's!"
The cap had been found down an alleyway in Whitechapel. There had been reports of an altercation and a gunshot fired. By the time the local constable had arrived, he'd found only the cap, lying in a pool of blood.
"We saw the label marked Sinclair's, so we came straight here,"
Sergeant Thomas had said, his voice quiet and grave.
"Betteridge said he believed this cap belonged to Joe. I'm very, very sorry."
Sophie had had to grip the back of a chair to steady herself. They had been in danger so many times, in Paris, St Petersburg, and here in London, and yet however frightening things had been, somehow they had always made it back to Sinclair's to talk about their adventures over tea and buns. Somehow she had believed they always would. Dimly, she'd become aware that May was crying, and Lil was saying in a loud voice that there had obviously been a mistake. The cap couldn't possibly be Joe's. He'd been investigating on Fleet Street, so what would he be doing in Whitechapel? Yes, he was missing, but he was probably just busy with an investigation. Perhaps he was following a suspect undercover. He was certain to be back soon, probably with some important information for them all.
"Miss Rose, in the circumstances..."
Sergeant Thomas had begun awkwardly, but Lil had cut him off before he could finish his sentence.
"Of course he isn't dead," she'd exploded. "That's ridiculous. You haven't found a body. All you've got is that stupid old cap."
Billy had glanced at Sophie. His face had been very white, and Sophie knew that he had been thinking the same thing she was. When people were murdered in the East End, they weren't left for the police to find. They'd found a body washed up in the river themselves once. It had been Joe who'd helped pull it out. A summer day, white frocks and straw hats and strawberries and cream, and then the horror of the body being dragged out of the water. It had all flashed back to her in that dreadful moment.
"Anyway, even if the cap is his, it doesn't prove anything," Lil had argued. "He might be injured. He might be hiding, lying low somewhere out of danger. But he isn't dead. He can't be."
She had repeated the same thing again and again over the next few days. She'd refused to accept the official verdict. Missing, believed killed. One cap didn't prove anything. Joe would come back, she'd insisted. She was certain of it. Sergeant Thomas was an idiot. Scotland Yard didn't know what they were talking about. But the days, and then the weeks, had limped by with no more news. Somehow, they had to carry on. There were clients waiting for them,
long-lost relatives to seek out, missing jewels to be located, blackmailers to catch in the act, stolen letters to be retrieved. There were accounts to balance and bills to pay, rather more of these than Sophie would have liked. Between all the travelling for the bureau and the search for Joe, they were behind on their ordinary casework, and Taylor and Rose was beginning to struggle financially. Lil was too preoccupied with looking for Joe to notice or care, but Sophie knew that she must not let their business fail. One way or another, they'd stumbled through December. Christmas had come and gone, and now it was 1912, a brand new year. Sitting at her table in Lyon's Corner House, Sophie suddenly wished none of it had ever happened. She wished she'd never heard of the Fraternitas Draconum, the Secret Service Bureau, double agents, or spies. She wished she was only a more or less ordinary shop girl, with nothing to think about except selling hats. But she knew she could never be that girl again. Just then, the door opened and a young man in a striped scarf came in, bringing with him a gust of cold air. Billy Parker looked a great deal older and more serious than he used to as he came over to Sophie's table and dropped down in the chair opposite her. "Did you get it?" "Of course," frowned Billy, looking a little insulted she'd even asked the question. "Here." He handed over a small square package wrapped in brown paper before reaching under the table to make a fuss of Daisy. Sophie tore off the wrapping to reveal a Russian phrasebook, tilting it so that there was no chance of any of the other customers could see inside. She flipped it open to reveal a note in familiar inky scribble. "Tonight at the usual place, 8 p.m. She closed the book with a snap, tucking it safely into her pocket. "Thanks, Billy. Have some tea?" "Yes, please. Are you going to eat that bun?" "You can have it." She pushed it in his direction and he broke it in half, taking one piece and pushing the other half back towards her. For a few moments, they sat in silence, chewing, trying not to look at the two empty chairs at the table. After a while, Billy said, "I suppose I'd better go back to the office. I've got to write up that report on the Mountville case." "I'm going to the bureau," said Sophie. In spite of everything, she was glad of it. After all that had happened, her work for the Secret Service Bureau now felt more important than ever. What had happened to Joe made her all the more determined to do everything in her power to stop the Fraternitas for good. It had stopped sleeting when she said goodbye to Billy and Daisy and went on her way to the bureau. She could have taken a motor taxi or at least an omnibus, but she decided to save the penny and walk to Lincoln's Inn, taking a grim pleasure in the icy wind against her cheeks. She walked fast and was soon crossing the courtyard towards the headquarters of the Secret Service Bureau. It seemed a long time since she and Lil had first come here, full of curiosity, thrilled by the chance to work for the government. Now it had become routine, and yet there was a wariness too. She could not forget that someone connected to this office was secretly working for the Fraternitas, and the same someone was no doubt behind what had happened to Joe in the East End. The chief's office looked just the same as it had on that first visit. The bookcase was still crammed with leather-bound books. The big map on the wall was still studded with pins and coloured flags. The desk was still stacked with papers and letters, pencils and blotters, diagrams and typed reports. The only thing that had changed was the music that was playing on the big gramophone in the corner. Today, Sophie detected the strains of Vivaldi's Four Seasons. The chief himself had not changed either. He was the same affable-looking old gentleman he had always been,
humming in time to the music as he scrawled his signature in green ink at the bottom of a document and then set it carefully aside.
"Ah, Miss Taylor, do come in and sit down. A most unpleasant day."
As Sophie took a seat in the chair opposite him, amongst the papers on his desk, her eye snagged on the same edition of the daily picture she'd read that morning, with the story about the German spies. What did the chief make of that, she wondered.
"I won't keep you long. As a matter of fact, this is going to be rather a short meeting," he was saying.
"Is it?" asked Sophie in surprise.
"Indeed it is."
The chief sat back in his chair and smiled at her.
"I have some good news for you, Miss Taylor. You are, as they say, off the hook."
Sophie only stared at him. She couldn't imagine what he meant.
"I shan't be needing your services for the moment," said the chief cheerfully. "You and Miss Rose may consider yourselves released from the Secret Service Bureau."
Chapter 3. Secret Service Bureau HQ, London.
"Released from the Bureau? Is there some sort of a problem?" Sophie faltered.
"A problem? Oh, my dear, my goodness, of course not," exclaimed the chief. "You know how delighted I am with your work, and Miss Rose's too, of course. It's simply that I don't expect to have a new assignment for you for the time being."
Sophie felt astonished. Quite apart from anything else, now more than ever, Taylor and Rose needed the generous fees they earned from the Bureau, and there had never been any shortage of work for them before, she thought. If anything, she'd heard the chief say many times that there was too much work and not enough agents to cover it. What was going on?
"I don't have anything suitable, you see. No assignments that are the right fit for young ladies like yourselves," the chief was saying.
"But what about the fraternitas?" asked Sophie.
"Ah, you may rest assured that things are moving forwards on that score. And of course, I will keep you updated on any significant progress. But for now, you've done your part, and done it very well, I might add."
The chief smiled again.
"You have worked hard. The last few months must have been exhausting, and tremendously difficult with what happened to your young associate. Tragic business. Most unfortunate. If you'll permit me, Miss Taylor, might I suggest that this would be a good moment for you and Miss Rose to take a holiday?"
"A holiday?" Sophie repeated. What was the chief up to?
"I know you are a hard worker, Miss Taylor, but even the best of us need a holiday every now and again, don't we? Rest and recuperation is important, and a change of scenery, perhaps. No sense in overdoing it, you know?"
he finished in an unexpectedly firm voice, fixing her with a sharp, bright gaze. "I suppose we could think about it," she murmured.
"Very good, Miss Taylor. You do that," said the chief. "Well, I'll be in touch when I need your services again. Thank you, my dear. Good afternoon."
Sophie got to her feet. The chief did not even glance at her as she left. He had already turned back to his documents and was once more humming under his breath. Outside the chief's door, Sophie found that the Bureau was unexpectedly busy. Normally, there was only Captain Carruthers lounging back in his chair, studying a document, but today it seemed full of people. A messenger boy was at Carruthers' desk, waiting for him to sign for a stack of official-looking envelopes. Across the room, the tall, bronzed, and handsome Captain Forsyth was deep in confidential conversation with a surly-looking fellow in a dark raincoat whom Sophie knew by sight as another agent, Mr. Brooks.
They both looked over at her as she came out of the chief's office, and her cheeks flushed pink. The door had been open. Had they heard she wasn't being given a new assignment? For them, of course, it would simply reinforce the idea that Sophie and Lil were lesser agents, and that working with female detectives was a waste of the Bureau's time. She hurried past them, muttering only a quick, "Good morning," and barely making eye contact with Carruthers as she passed his desk. On their mission to St. Petersburg, he'd become something of a friend, and normally she'd have stopped to chat with him, but now she was eager to get away. Back at Sinclair's, Sophie went straight to the offices of Taylor and Rose, hurrying past the reception desk where May was on the telephone and passing the door of Billy's office without a pause. She knew they'd be waiting to hear what the chief had said, but she didn't feel like talking. Instead, she went into the office she shared with Lil, closing the door behind her and flopping down into her chair with a long sigh. The Russian phrasebook was still in her pocket. She took it out and opened it, and read the note again. "Tonight at the usual place, 8 p.m. The words were reassuring. It was 3 o'clock now, and she certainly had enough work to keep her busy until then, she thought, eyeing the stacks of paper on her desk. But as she opened an account book, she felt fidgety and unable to concentrate. Her mind was still running over the day's events, the newspaper stories, German spies, the fraternitas, the meeting at the bureau, Brooks and Forsyth looking at her knowingly. Tragic business, most unfortunate. She knew she did not have time to be distracted. There was a great deal of work to be done, more than they could easily manage. They really needed to take on some more part-time help, she thought, but could they afford it? She frowned at the account book, and then began jotting down some possible wording for a job advertisement. But after a moment, she gave it up again. What she really needed was to talk it over with Lil. But Lil wasn't here. She pushed the account book aside and instead turned her attention to a file of information about a new case that Billy had left for her. Before long, she was so engrossed that she did not even notice the light ebbing from the sky. Her head was still bent over the file when Billy put his head round the door to say he was taking Daisy out for her evening walk. She only said, when May appeared a little later to say they were going home now and should she lock the office door. It was not until 7:45 that Sophie looked up and realized it was quite dark outside, and if she did not hurry, she was going to be late. Leaving the file on her desk, Sophie put on her hat and coat and slipped out of the now empty office and down the back stairs. She'd once found the deserted store rather creepy at night, but now it seemed comforting and familiar. She sucked in a deep breath of the warm air, fragranced with rose and violet, and the spicy, heady aroma that made her think of rich furs and the cigars that Papa used to smoke after dinner. Outside, the wind felt very cold against her face, smelling instead of motor car fumes and bitter smoke. A cold rain was falling, and she was glad of the shelter of her umbrella as she splashed through the puddles and out into the street. Even on a gloomy February evening, Piccadilly Circus was full of lights, sparkling with the brightness of street lamps and motor car headlights and illuminated advertisements for Bovril and Perrier. But Sophie turned quickly away from the glitter of shops and restaurants, hurrying across Regent Street towards the darker streets of Soho that lay beyond. Here, the wide roads gave way to a twisty labyrinth of poorly lit streets lined with little shops, pubs, and eating houses. Sophie took a winding route along them, glancing up into a darkened window every now and again to check the street behind her. It had become a habit, but tonight more than usual she wanted to make sure she wasn't being followed. She turned a corner, past a coffee merchant's, past an ironmonger's shop all shut up for the night, and then turned again,
heading down a dark, cobbled alleyway between two crooked buildings. Halfway down it was a doorway. Once more, Sophie checked quickly around her to be sure she was alone before turning the handle and slipping through, closing the door behind her. Once inside the dark, shabby hall, she went swiftly up a steep, narrow staircase, the stairs creaking beneath her feet. On the second floor landing, lit only by a single flickering gas lamp, she stopped and knocked sharply on a door. A moment later, it had opened a crack.
"Miss Taylor," said a stern voice from inside. "Come in. You're late."
Chapter 4. A Secret Location. Soho, London. As the door closed on the dark stairwell, Sophie stepped into a small, snug sitting room, so different from what lay outside that it was hard to believe she was still in the same building. It was comfortably furnished with a blazing fire in the hearth and several cozy armchairs drawn up around it. A table was set with cups and a jug of cocoa and a plate of currant buns, and Sophie, who had missed her tea, heard her stomach rumble.
"Miss Taylor," came a familiar voice from the depths of one of the large armchairs. "Ignore my grandson's bad manners and come in and warm yourself, my dear. Sam, pour a cup of cocoa. There's a good fellow."
The chief's feet were resting comfortably on a footstool before the fire while he puffed on his pipe. He gestured to the armchair beside him, and Sophie sat down thankfully, shedding her damp coat, hat, and umbrella, while Captain Carruthers, who as well as being the chief's assistant was also his grandson, rather grumpily hung them up and poured her a cup of cocoa. The three of them had been using this Soho room as a secret meeting place ever since November, when she'd returned from St Petersburg and told the chief about the double agent.
"If the Bureau truly has been infiltrated, then we cannot be too careful," the chief had said. "We cannot count on any conversations at the office remaining confidential. We must have a safe place we can talk."
No one else could know about their safe house or the conversations that took place there. It was very important to make sure the double agent did not suspect they had been discovered.
"If they know we are suspicious, they will begin trying to cover their tracks," the chief had said. "But if they don't, well, we may be able to find out who they are, and then we can work them to our advantage."
"You mean they might lead us to some of the members of the fraternitas?" Carruthers had asked.
"Or we could use them to feed false information back to the fraternitas," suggested Sophie. "To mislead them and disrupt their plans."
"Indeed," said the chief, nodding to them both. "But best of all, we could persuade them to reconsider their loyalties, to return to our side and spy on the fraternitas for us."
"So the double agent would become a triple agent?" Sophie had asked.
"Precisely,"
said the chief with a little smile, rubbing his hands together as though he relished the challenge. In the days and weeks that had followed, Sophie and Lil had concentrated all their efforts on finding Joe and the mysterious woman, but all the while, the chief and Carruthers had been busy with investigations of their own, doing everything they could to identify the double agent that had been passing her secrets. It would not be easy, for they knew very little about him except what Joe had told Billy. He had watched a man whose face he had never seen clearly leaving the bureau with some documents, which he had then hidden for a woman to collect. Carruthers had set up a way for them to communicate secretly via messages left inside books in the Charing Cross bookshop. But this was their first real meeting in weeks, and after what the chief had said at the bureau earlier that day,
Sophie was more eager than ever to hear what he had to tell her.
"No Miss Rose this evening?" asked the chief. "She's still busy with your other cases, I suppose?"
"That's right," said Sophie swiftly, her cheeks turning a little pink as she took a sip of her cocoa. It was not exactly a lie, but she felt uncomfortable saying it just the same, especially when Carruthers was looking at her through narrowed eyes, as though he guessed exactly what was really going on.
"Well, you can brief her, of course," said the chief, nodding amiably. "Thank you for cooperating with my little subterfuge earlier. I am sure you realize that I have no plans to release you just yet. You and Miss Rose are far too useful for that."
He gave a little chuckle, and Sophie felt herself relax. She'd guessed that the scene in the chief's office earlier had been a ruse, but she felt better now that it had been confirmed.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.